Welcome to La Plagne in the French Alps, the venue for the 1992 Winter Olympic sliding sports. And we are at 1,300 meters above sea level, just below one of France's busiest ski resorts. We're here for round five at the Viessmann FIBT World Cup and into the first of two runs for the women's bobsleigh. Hello, everybody. I'm Martin Haven, sitting alongside me, Kurt Tomasevich. Kurt, this track at La Plagne rejoined the World Cup schedule last year, so everybody's, I guess, still learning its secrets.
Yeah, it's very, very few drivers on this circuit that have actually driven this track other than maybe a Europa Cup race here or there. But, you know, now that they're on with the World Cup circuit, it's pretty fair playing field for all the drivers.
Well, one of the first things is how long the start is.
Yeah, it's very different compared to other tracks. It's very flat and very long. So the start times are going to be much higher than other tracks, and they're going to be more spread out as well. That's not necessarily an indication of, you know, who's starting faster, you know, compared to other tracks and that sort of thing. But for the most part, you're going to see a big difference in the start times.
Well, the other thing, of course, is that there's no straightaway here. It's just corner, 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 corner. And for the crew, that must mean a lot of pressure loading you down into the sled.
Yeah, definitely. You know, it's very similar to Lake Placid, where there's not much break in between the curves. It's just curve after curve, labyrinth, and then big omega curves. You know, it never seems to stop. There's a little bit of a break, you know, right before the last two curves, in between curve 18 and 19. But for the most part, it's just nonstop driver action.
Climbing uphill through the final sequence to the finish line. Track record set by Kathleen Martini last season, the December race last year. And here we are back again, just a couple of days beyond the year. Almost 20 years now since the Winter Games in Albertville used this track that was built in 1988. So Alana Myers of the USA heads our start list. A bronze and a silver medal so far this season, her best two results. She's yet to take to the top step of the podium because that's been rather selfishly hogged by Canada's Kaylee Humphreys. She, of course, is among our top 10 starters in a field of 19 sleds, including a second sled from Great Britain for the first time this year. So getting ready then with the start record holders, Alana Myers and Katie Ebeling, and it was this pairing that set the track start record, 6.4 seconds. Now everywhere else, Kurt Tomasevich, you're looking at low fives. Here it's mid sixes. This is a long sprint.
Yeah, you're gonna see these push athletes drive. They're gonna have to stay low in long strides. You know, keep their hips low to the ice in order to keep that sled moving, because it's not gonna pick up speed as it does on other tracks.
Well, Alana Myers has got to be one of the standout break women in the women's game. That doesn't hurt that she's driving a dream as well. Long run and in they get. Record is 6.40, and they are just 200ths away from that.
Yeah, again, you know, it's a little bit warmer than I think it was last year, a little bit more cloud cover, and the conditions always play a huge factor in how the ice feels to the driver, and especially in the start times as well.
Well, one of the things, of course, is that half of the training week was bitterly cold, minus 10, minus 12, and the ice was really brittle and fast. And the other half has been considerably slower. So I guess the drivers are trying to balance what they know with what they're expecting.
Yeah, it was very difficult for drivers to choose runners, you know, how to set up their sled and suspension and that sort of thing the first couple days of training, just because we knew that as the weekend came, the weather was going to get warmer, the ice was going to get softer, and that was going to be a huge factor come race day. So we'll see how it affects everything.
Nice looking run from Alana Myers. Oh,
little
rattle on the wall. See the warmth, some of the snow falling off the roofs, doesn't fall into the track. There's enough of an overhang. 101.79, and again, you know, the number of tracks where it takes more than a minute to get down, you can count on two fingers. It's here and St. Moritz that are that long.
Yeah, there's a lot of length to this track, and it's a little bit slower and softer compared to last year, compared to Martini's run last year that set the track record. We're about 7/10 of a second off of that. So, you know, you can't tell until another few sleds come down the track, but that looked like a pretty good run for Alana.
Well, this is right at the bottom where we're starting to go uphill now. And that long skid, that's just like putting your foot on the brake. It's not helping. Well, the fastest time in the men's skeleton this morning was a 60.80 second run. And that was a 61.80 second run. So a second slower than the quickest of the skeletons. And that seems to suggest that the track might not be as quick as it was in the cold of the morning. Next up, Jamie Grubel from the USA, from Arlington, Massachusetts. Bodine USA 2 sled.
And you can see, compared to other tracks, how the push athlete has to keep their feet low to the ice. They really have to drive. Every step has to be have a lot of power behind it.
Well, this is less a 50-meter or 50-yard dash and more a full 100 meters, isn't it? I mean, it's a long, long run.
Yeah, it almost feels like you're pushing that sled uphill because we're so used to the sled picking up speed, you know, as you go downhill. This is so flat, that resistance of the sled, it really feels like you're you have a lot to push.
Whoa, ooh. Nice high line through six, but she controlled the exit nicely. Now, will that help her build up speed? She seems to be hanging on to Alana Myers, still just 1,200s behind.
Starting to pull back, get close, now 1,100s.
Top speed, 125. Alana was 124.1. That's 77.7 miles an hour. Now she could well move into the lead. If she gets a clean run here, that's not quite as bad.
Alana had a little bit of a skid there. Jamie did take that tap, but it's, yeah, you can see where that pulled allowed her to pull ahead.
Again, that uphill section as you come down below our commentary position around the control tower, the main office building, had a loop around it in this three-corner sequence.
Yeah, this, sorry, Martin, this is definitely one of those tracks where depending on how your start is, you can still make up time as you go down. There's so many curves, and it's up to a lot of the driver's skill in order to get down to the track very quickly.
Really driving hard out of the blocks on the back handles, Emily Azevedo. And look, still head down. They're both looking over the brow.
That is an eternity for a push athlete to push that sled. You know, it just feels like you're running forever before you finally get the chance to jump in.
Well, depending on your body type, particularly in the two-man, is there a case maybe where you start a little less brutally and then try and allow yourself to run to top speed? Or
well, there's some different theories about when to load. You know, maybe you don't want to load at quite top speed, because you want to keep that velocity building, keep that acceleration going higher and higher. You know, sometimes people think you need to run the sled as far as possible and get a really good start time, you know, and not pay as close attention to that start velocity.
Interesting, holes open on the front of the Swiss sled. Normally, on the frontal area, you don't want holes unless it's for cooling. I don't think there's anything inside the sled needs cooling down.
Yeah, sometimes you'll see people or teams with the sleds like that that use pegs that go to the front of the sled. They'll tape over those holes.
There you go. And on a track this long, anything that might rob you of 100th is going to do it for 1,400 meters.
Good point.
Of course, what do I know? 2,900's back, though. She started a little slower than our race leaders, Jamie Grubel and Emily Azevedo. Fabian Mayer of Switzerland. Again, you know, the more corners there are, the less your start dominates the rest of your performance.
You're right, and I think Fabian, you know, she's a great driver, good equipment. I think she could start to reel in the Americans just a little bit as it gets closer down.
Same speed down towards the bottom as Alana Myers, but she's a little way behind.
Yeah, just didn't have that start velocity that the Americans didn't. That she wasn't able to reel it in, even though she is a great driver.
Well, we come here from Winterberg in Germany, Kurt, where it was hundredths of a second you were looking at between the sleds. Here, we're more likely to be looking at tenths of a second because there are so many more opportunities to make a mistake. 19 corners.
Yeah, it's definitely a little bit more spread out. Again, that start time is a little bit longer, so the start times are going to be spread out. The downtime is over a minute. That's going to be spread out a little bit more. So it might not come down to hundredths of seconds like we usually see.
Fabian Mayer of Switzerland lying in third place. And next up, Christina Hengster of Austria, the reigning junior world champion. And like Mayer, she's a driver who doesn't quite have that explosive start that we've seen from the two American girls. But again, 19 opportunities to get the line right. And her brake woman, very upright it seemed, on the blocks. Let's see what their start looks like. Anything below 670, okay, 671, that's about where you might expect to find them.
Yeah, but what she does have is great equipment. She uses her sled as the fixer of her runs. You know, she can really drive well, but, you know, more than anything, she relies on great equipment. And that comes from, you know, just a lot of background with the Austrian program. And, you know, now they're co-opting a little bit with the Italians and putting together a pretty good program.
Couple of taps on the wall. Well, the Austrian kit Wolfgang Stampfer sleds were always really good at high speeds. They just moshed away from anybody else, no matter what his start was like. So she'll be hoping that there's a lot of that here. This is a little of a bumpy ride, though.
She was 38 hundredths of a second back. Now she's starting to reel that in down to 36, but we'll see where her speed is coming down here.
Well, it was 125.8, a kilometre an hour quicker than our race leader in USA 2, Jamie Grubel, and that's a clean run down the straightaway. That could take another tenth out of the lead. She could go up in two. Yeah, quarter of a second back, third place. Well, again, you know, she was gradually catching up from the good start of the two American girls with every meter of ice.
Yeah, this track is really funny because they were 38 hundredths of a second back, and in order to, they did finish only 26 hundredths of a second back, but those 12 hundredths of a second to gain in just driving, that's really saying something, but on this track, that's just not enough.
Great velocity from the sled at the bottom as well, 125.8, that's just a whisker under 78 miles an hour. But again, even here with that start, she's always looking to come back at the leaders. There is Austrian brakewoman Inge Versen, and there is your driver, Christina Hengster. Now then, Sandra Kyriassis with Berit Viaka on the back of her sled this weekend. Berit braked for Kathleen Martini in Germany 1 last weekend. So again, swapping the athletes around.
Even with Berit on the back end of her sled, Sandra isn't known for great starts either. So if she's 670 or better, you know, she can maybe drive back from that. But we're right at 670, so we'll see how she does.
Well, Berit was running that almost to corner two. Such a long run. Sandra was in and had the D-rings before Berit Viaka loaded. 65.5, that's good speed in the first trap, but not quite as good as the Americans.
And Sandra, again, probably the best driver, arguably, on tour. You know, she can really drive her equipment, especially. And, you know, she's already down to, the lead is only 31 hundredths of a second right now. Might fall back just a little bit more before the next. Nope, she's already reeling it in, 28 hundredths.
Well, of course, this is one of the tracks where nobody has an advantage. None of these women raced on this track in World Cup racing before last year, and very few will have done a Europa Cup race at the lower tier of sliding, because the track's been effectively out of use for competition for nearly a decade.
A lot of speed on that 125.8. 125.4, but still just not enough to reel in the Americans.
Third place ahead of the Austrians and the Swiss. Of course, the women were not an Olympic discipline when the games were held here in 1992. Switzerland did win the two-man gold.
You know, it doesn't matter the push athlete or even the driver, but when you see the black, red, and yellow of Germany, it's always an intimidating factor.
Well, you can never count them out. It's like the USA, like Russia and Canada. You know, they'll bounce back from a disappointing weekend just as strong as before.
Yeah, she definitely had high speed toward the end of that, and that's just, again, goes back to her great driving and great equipment.
Now, somebody who should be able to at least match the Americans at the start is this woman, Anja Schneiderhein. So Germany won. She's got Franziska Bertels behind her this weekend. Okay. Again, we talked about Alana Myers being an epically strong brakewoman turned driver. Well, exactly the same with Anja. She was an Olympic gold medalist behind Sandra Kyriassis as a brakewoman. And 6.49, fastest slide apart from Alana Myers.
Yeah, she's got to be pretty happy with that. I mean, Schneiderhein's, again, has that great equipment. Maybe not the driver that Kyriassis is quite yet, but she does have the great push, and that's what she has as an advantage over Kyriassis, and that's what keeps her in the running.
High through six, a hundredth of a second behind. On this track, that is just the blink of an eye away.
Falling back a little bit, that shows you she just, even though she had a pretty good start time, she might not have had a lot of great start velocity. You know, just maybe they ran that slit a little bit too deep. 124.5 kilometers an hour, not as high as Kyriassis right before her.
And slower than our race leader, Jamie Grubel, as well. And this is underlining just what a great first run Jamie had.
Yeah, she was second off the hill, and it was, you know, maybe at the time hard to tell how great of a run it is, but, you know, fresh ice, and she's got to be pretty happy with that.
Yeah, she absolutely should. Anja Schneiderhein's are in fifth. Jamie Grubel leads her teammate Alana Myers. Behind her, Sandra Kyriassis third, Christina Hengster, Anja Schneider-Heinz of fifth, and sixth is Fabienne Meyer of Switzerland. So she's already got, you know, half the top 10 women in the world behind her. Some of these transitions look pretty severe in a modern sled,
yeah,
don't they?
You can tell she's a little early on to some of these curves, a little bit of a bump, and that's not quite the smooth entrance you probably want.
Christoph Langen took a bronze medal in the four-man here in 1992. That was his first big result as a driver. I wonder what ever happened to him after that. Jasmine Fenlater now with Lolo Jones on the back of the USA three sled. Now, this is going to be interesting to see just how far Lolo is going to run this out.
They really should have a great start here. You know, Lolo should be the sprinter, and their start time should be exceptionally high.
6:55, that's a really good start. Well, you know, you barely even saw Lolo behind Jess. She was so low.
Yeah, that's what you have to do when you push a sled on this flat flat type of start. You really have to keep your hips low to the ground and drive the entire time. You don't want to bring your hips up and stand up too tall too early.
And the shoulders are low as well. 10th of a second off the lead of Jamie Grubel.
Little late off that exit. Slipping back just a little bit, but overall it's a pretty good run. A little early there, you can see the sled kind of bumped as she went into there.
1:23.2, and that's the lowest speed we've seen so far, so she's steering hard to keep the line.
All those little mistakes are just starting to add up just a little bit. It's not a horrible run, and nothing's really standing out.
Ooh.
Other than that skid right there, but she's not going to be real pleased with this downtime.
Take another 10th out and drops her behind Fabienne Meyer of Switzerland. Well, a run that started so well, drifted away from her once she got into down corner 15:16. 6:55 start for Jasmine Fenlater and Lolo Jones.
Yeah, one thing that Lolo should bring to this to the table here is her drive. You know, and the hurdles that she's known for, being an Olympic hurdler, that starts. You know, those first few steps where you really have to get out and build your velocity in just those first few steps in order to carry over the rest of the hurdles. That's where she should be able to carry it off. But Jasmine just, you know, off that last exit there, not a real smooth transition.
Yeah, a little bumpy ride. You see some of the drivers getting bounced out of their seats. Great load from Lolo Jones as well. Head never looked like coming up at all. She just went straight in. Well, next up, Esme Campos with another Olympic athlete. Willie Canis behind her is a multiple world BMX champion and track cyclist. So maybe not the greatest for long runs. 6:68.
A lot of power, and actually I had the chance to train with Willie in Colorado Springs this past summer. They did a lot of their sprint cycling training before the London Games there. So, you know, I'm a witness to how strong she is, you know, with squats and cleans and a lot of leg power behind that sled.
The only slight problem with track cyclists is their thighs do different things, very different from a runner. And so that needs retraining, and that may take some time. But to get athletes of the caliber of Willie and Lolo Jones coming into bobsledding is great for the women's sport.
Definitely, it should build popularity. You know, they bring in a whole different type of fan base.
This is a good, smooth-looking run from the Dutch sled.
Half a second back so far, 1:24.1 speed.
Well, you know, where are the mistakes that is robbing her of all this time? Has there maybe been a mistake on the runner setup?
Again, there's just so many curves on this track where the driver could make small, tiny errors that, you know, maybe even some we can't even see on the television here.
Well, they come in eighth place, 1:02.52. Well, Kurt, during training, I know Lyndon Rush was saying that the track got a couple seconds slower between the first heat and second heat events training. And I wonder whether the ambient temperature being a little bit above freezing is just starting to have a degrading effect on the track.
Some of these curves are very sharp, and we have pretty high speed. There's a lot of pressure in those, and that can deteriorate the ice even quicker.
The other thing is, if they've trained on runners for really hard ice, they may just be digging in too much on a softer surface if they're racing on. There is the Dutch sled, currently lying in eighth spot. 19 sleds in the field. So next up is the Olympic champion, Kaylee Humphries. She's 4 for 4 this season, as is brakewoman Chelsea Valois. That's 4 for 4 in her career.
Yeah, it's a pretty amazing statistic to go by. But you know, Kaylee won here last year. This is, you know, definitely the favorite right now. 6:47, giving her a good start time.
Only 500s away from Alana Myers, who has the fastest start, but she leads the race.
Pretty good start velocity, 65.7 kilometers an hour. We talked about how it's not just the start time, but it's how fast that sled is moving when it breaks that start timing eye.
Well, we'll be able to find out later in the second heat exactly how she matches this performance. And the rest of the weekend, she'll be in a hot seat in the booth here as well, talking through the men's bobsled action. 400s of a second, the lead.
Little early onto that exit, but pretty good. You know, she's pulling away 700s, not a lot of mistakes. 125.8 kilometers an hour.
That's quicker than Jamie Grubel. She will take the lead of the race at the line. 1200s up. What will the margin be? 15, 16, 1700s of a second. Another great drive. 2/10. Yes.
Just another example of why she's won 4 races in a row this season. You know, world championship last season. She's just, you know, all around the best pilot right now.
Well, so much for the track slowing down then.
True. Yeah, she had a, you know, came out of a hole as a ninth draw, which isn't an easy thing to come back and take the lead with, but she did well.
She sure did. And again, she leads after the first heat.
Again, most of the drivers are getting onto that curve a little early. Maybe that's their strategy, is to get onto that curve early.
Great speed at the bottom as well. Same as Christina Hengster, 125.8. Now that's vital, you know, because it carries you to the line.
Yeah, there's so many curves down this track that, you know, if you don't have that speed going into those last few curves, it's really hard to make up that time.
Well, next up, Kathleen Martini and Stephanie Schneider. Last year's women's race won by Kaylee Humphreys from Kathleen, who had Yanina Tischer behind her then. I think we've seen Yanina Tischer start a race yet this season.
Just like Kyriassis, another German driver, Martini doesn't have the greatest start time, a 6:61, not bad, but you know, right in the middle of the pack so far. But you know, they rely on that equipment that they have, great driving skill, good coaching.
Well, you know, we, again, comparing to Winterberg last weekend, short track start really overrides pretty much anything else you can do. Here, the drivers have got a real chance to exert themselves.
Yeah, the way the schedule's set up this year, it's kind of alternates between the two. You know, Lake Placid is a driver's track. Park City is a pusher's track. Then we went to Whistler, which is a driver's track. And back to Winterberg in Germany, where, you know, the push athletes can really make a difference in the race. And now here, the drivers can make a difference.
Well, at the moment, Kathleen is in 6th, decent speed, but she's not closing at all on our race leader, Kaylee Humphreys. Still 6th position on the split times. Really where you expect to see the German bobsled women. A little rattle there as she comes to the line, and it is still 6th position.
Yeah, it's rare that you don't see the Germans in the top three, and right now they're sitting at 4th, 6th, and 7th. And
Martini just 200s ahead of teammate Anja Schneiderhein, so that's Germany 3 and Germany 1. And Germany 2, Sandra Kyriassis in 4th place, and you're right, you know, she's 2/10 away from a medal, even Sandra.
Hear that long, slow, flat start, and that's very difficult, you know, sometimes for drivers that rely on, you know, just their driving ability. They're always coming from behind, and that's not an easy thing to do.
Well, that is 10 of our 19 sleds down. Kaylee Humphreys leads with Chelsea Falwa behind her. Jamie Grubel second, Alana Myers third for the USA. Stay with us for more from Lapland.
Break of two minutes. Et se prépare Paula Walker, Julian Cook for Great Britain. Voici le classement actuel de général de cette Coupe du Monde. Donc au premier rang, vous trouvez le bon canadien Kay Humphreys. Ensuite, globalement, Sandra Kyriassis en deuxième position de ce classement mondial. En troisième place, Elana Meyers, USA. Quatrième place, Kathleen Martini, Germany, Allemagne. Cinquième place, Christina Hengster, Autriche. Classement provisoire de cette première manche. Et Kaylee Humphreys Frank, deuxième Jenny Gravel, troisième Elana Myers. One minute, next start in 1 minute. Quatrième Sandra Kipriasis, cinquième Christine Kingster. Placement provisoire, aujourd'hui, la première manche. Au départ, Bob, the Bob start for gripping the corner. La piste est libre, la track is clear.
Welcome back to La Plagne in the fifth round of the Women's Bobsleigh World Cup. This is GB1, the first of two Great Britain sleds. Paula Walker with Jill Cook behind her. And Paula Walker with two top six results so far this season as her best finishes. Now, Paula, big strong driver, and Jill, a former distance hurdler. So this should be a good combination, Kurt Tomasevich, to get the sled moving and then to run the speed into it.
Yeah, being a distance hurdler, you know, this is about the closest we have to a distance type of event, I guess, you know, where we have to run the sled just a little bit farther, a few more cycles than what we're used to on different starts.
Well, 6:61 getaway, decent first speed trap velocity as well, not the fastest.
Paula right now ranked number 11 in the world. You know, if she can just slip into number 10, that's going to open the door for a lot more opportunities, because then you're in the top 10 draw. So then you can get better ice, you know, a better opportunity to have a great start and be more in the mix.
At the moment, looking for her third top six finish of the season, and that will guarantee another layer of funding. And all of that helps the British bobsledding program. Of course, it doesn't go directly to the athlete. Goes into the pot. 124 kilometers an hour. Not great speed, though.
Coming through curve 16, you know, that's one of the higher pressure curves. She had a little bit of a wave, you know. You can see she came in nice and came in a little too high, and then the pressure kind of fell away, and she kind of fell to the bottom of the curve just a little bit. And those little things add up.
Well, there's your coach, Pete Gunn. Paula Walker in 10th place ahead of Esme Campus of the Netherlands after the first heat. She's going to need to tidy that up a little if they're to get a top six finish here, though.
Here you can see how the natural lines that most sleds are going to take are in the, you know, you can see where the sleds before her have gone. And you can see how she's kind of waving, going back and forth around those lines. She takes the tap on her right side coming out of that exit. That's just a kind of a speed killer.
Yeah, if you're low on the exit, it slings you into that outside wall. So there is Paula Walker. Next up, Jennifer Cacchetti and Emily Badsvik. This is the Canada 2 sled. Quite upright running style, I always think, from Jenny Cacchetti.
Emily, though, her push athlete, does have good experience on this track. She was part of Kaylee Humphrey's team last year when they won the race.
And if it hadn't been for just a random phone call from Chelsea Valois to Bobsleigh Skeleton Canada, she would still be on the back of that
probably
sled.
Yep. Yeah. See, Jennifer took that little tap coming between curve 3 and 4, and that kind of killed some of that start velocity. Now she's just falling a little bit farther and farther away.
3800's back. She's gone from 6th at the start down to 9th place. Again, although we've seen a lot of Jennifer, it's been as a brake woman. This is her first season driving at the top level, only her second season driving full stop. And that was interrupted by returning to the back seat to win the World Championship with Kaylee Humphrey. So really, this is still a debutante season.
Yeah, within the last 9 months, both these athletes have pushed with Kaylee Humphreys.
Yes.
But, you know, she's still learning as a driver and still trying to get experience. If I'm not mistaken, this might be her first week on this track.
Yes.
So, you know, she's got a lot to learn, but, you know, she's not doing too bad. Yeah, it's definitely a very upright pushing style that Jennifer has on the push bar.
And you think, well, that's kind of odd because, you know, she's a brake woman, or has been a brake woman really up until the last sort of 18 months where she started driving. And you sort of might imagine that it seems unnatural to be so upright.
But sometimes push athletes, you know, they just have that natural running style where their hips are up underneath them just a little bit more. And that's just, you know, how they are fast.
Another Summer Olympic Games medalist now. Then she was Olga Fedorova, now Olga Stulneva on the front of this Russia one sled, Yulia Timofeeva behind her. And those little pink things you can see, they're bungee straps that are supporting the driver's D-rings. Olga, silver medal in the 4x100 in Athens. 6.69. Again, you know, one of the things you find with sprinters, of course, Kurt, is body weight is death. You know, the heavier you are, the more you've got to shift. That's not so much the case in bobsledding, but, you know, slicer sprinters do run at a disadvantage.
Yeah, we always say it takes mass to move mass. You know, the bigger, the stronger you are, you know, the more weight you're going to be able to move. At the same time, you have to be light to run with the sled, too. So, it's, you know, you got to find that happy medium. But, you know, it seems like every week we've been talking about how the Russian women's program needs to find something and make something click. And, you know, it just never seems like they fulfill their potential, really.
They need some start monsters. 124.1, that's not bad velocity. I mean, there's not much wrong with the kit. There's not much wrong, essentially, with the athletes. But, you know, starting 660 as opposed to 640-something, that just leaves you with a huge hole to fill.
Yeah, we have two more Russians to come down. Gomer there, you know, the coach of the Russian Federation, you know, he's always, you know, trying to find little places where they can improve, but it just hasn't seemed to work so far this year. You know, they had the 11th fastest start, they finished across the finish line in 11th place. So, you know, you can see how that start time does correlate to that finish time, even on this track.
Well, again, look at Olga on the front handles, much more driving forward running style than Jennifer Cacchetti that we were just looking at, but they just don't seem to have the power to really get the sled moving.
Yeah, you can see how there must be a little bit of a bump on the entrance of that curve right there, because it seems like every sled that's gone in there has that little bump on the right side, even though they're trying to get into that curve a little earlier.
I guess you'll be finding that out tomorrow. Anastasia Tambov-Saver and Margarita Ishmailova now. This is Russia 2.
Even though she has the number 6 on the front of her sled, which means she is ranked number 6 from the World Cup standings last year coming into this season, she just really hasn't had a great season so far this year. She's, you know, way back at almost every start. You know, her start this time was ranked last so far in this race. So, you know, she's got a lot of work to do in every track she goes to, and it just hasn't been working for the Russian program.
Well, it really tells you everything that her best result is 13th place in Park City. That's why she's so far down in the World Cup rankings at 14th.
Yep, it seems with Schneider-Hines and Kaylee Humphreys and the American program, how everybody's trying to take good push athletes and turn them into drivers. And, you know, that's just, you know, the way the program, the women's sport seems to be going right now. And the Russian program just really hasn't quite bought into that quite yet.
Well, part of the problem is they don't have great push monsters yet. And so, you're just replacing, you know, a fairly powerful athlete on the front handles with another fairly powerful athlete. You know, the arrival of people like Kaylee, of Alana, of Jen, you know, really top 5 brake women on the front of the sled, then means that you've sort of really upped the power on the front.
Well, I guess the men may be setting a bad example for them, because their men drivers are not great pushers. But somehow the men's program with Zubkov, they're really doing well. So maybe they're, you know, giving argument to the fact that you don't need good push athletes on the driver's bar. But at the same time, it seems to be that the program, or the direction that the women's programs are going.
Well, I would take that on board. I would counter that with the fact that our Olympic four-man champion has 3 great push athletes behind him, and you've got to have it. Got to have it. Next up for Australia, Astrid Radjanovic, with Fiona Harrison on the back handles. And was speculating last weekend whether she and husband Vuk Radjanovic was sharing the same fitness sled. They're not. They've got one each. They're just both white. That's all. Hence the confusion.
Ooh. Little trouble getting into the sled for the driver.
Well, you know, this is one of the things that we talked about in the skeleton race. Something that we saw a lot of in Winterberg that we don't see here is that tunneling effect into the first corner where sleds hit the wall. That doesn't happen. She wasn't steering and it still took her into the turn.
Yeah, in Winterberg, there's a little bit of a kink actually before curve number one. And that little kink is, you know, the driver has to have control of the D-rings before they go into that kink here. Apparently, you can get away with not having complete control of the sled, although she did have some trouble between curves 2, 3, and 4. And that might have been a result of not having complete control of the sled going in and out of curve one.
Well, 2,800s off at the start. She was 5,500s off at the second clock, and she's 2 kilometers an hour down on top speed. So that has all caught up with her.
Yep, just didn't have the speed to begin with and not gaining any time coming down the track. She's got a lot of work to do.
Again, this is only her second ever week driving this sled, so she's got plenty of learning to do in this. She was in North America, she was using her familiar green one. Now a brand new sled, and she said it's just so different. Everything it does completely differently to the old one.
Yeah, and this is a track where it's probably going to be tough to pick up the feel of the sled because there's so many different types of curves. And here's what we were talking about. When she loads in, she gets her feet caught a little bit on possibly the D-rings. Not able to collapse her push bar until middle of curve one. But for the most part, it didn't seem to affect her right there, but it affected her maybe between curves 2, 3, and out of curve 18 there. She just didn't seem to have control of the sled there.
Next up, Caroline Spani and Ariane Falser. Now, I may be wrong, wouldn't be the first time. I think this is a World Cup debut for Ariane. I think she had Michelle Huberle behind her last weekend. Six to one. Again, it's not going to worry the fastest starters, but it's right in the middle of the pack.
Yeah, that's a good starting point for Spani. You know, she's hasn't had a great finish yet. You know, she just wants to slowly gain experience and gain some confidence. And, you know, seventh fastest start in this first heat, that should help a little bit.
Well, absolutely. And the Swiss sleds as well will be very quick at the high speeds that we pick up at the bottom of this track. That pre-assumes that she doesn't hit the wall all the way down.
Yeah.
3,700s back. This is still a top 10 run. Ooh, again, that violent take on there really does throw you out of the seat. 124. We're getting back the sort of speed that you might expect. Slipped out of the top 10, 11th place on split times. Ooh, that's going to cost her.
Yeah, a lot of taps on the left side of her sled as she comes through that short little straightaway.
So 12th place, 102.49, and that leaves her 300s ahead of Esme Campos, tied with Jennifer Cacchetti. So a little three-way battle going on there.
You know, we talked about earlier how these times are going to be a little bit more spread out, but seems to be proving us wrong a little bit with the tie for 12th place, and that's just 300s of a second ahead of 14th place.
Well, if that is Ariane Walser's World Cup debut, that was a pretty decent start. Seventh fastest for Caroline Spani in Swiss 2. You've got to like that. Now then, not making a World Cup debut. She made that in Samaritz last year, Vicky O. But this, I hope, is the start of a run of World Cup races for the GB2 sled. Victoria Alea from London and Kelly Denyer on the back handles.
Pretty good explosive start into that driver's push bar. And a lot of times you don't see the drivers mutilate their arms because they only get one step before they get into the push. A little bit of a different approach, and she might have done this on purpose, but when she got into the sled, she grabbed the D-rings right away and didn't worry about releasing her push bar until out of curve one. My guess is she didn't intend to do that, but that was a pretty venture move if that was her reaction to handle that after the curve.
10th at the start. And trailing away a little bit from a top 10 run, 13th spot at the moment. Now, I think that she has run on this track before, but it will only have been once. Now, of course, that's true for the World Cup regulars, but on the other hand, they've got a lot more experience to draw on. 122.0, like Paula Walker, no speed at the bottom, and that has got to be a worry. Both British sleds lacking in top end speed, but a neat drive the moment I said that. Of course, there's the slide.
Yeah, just without the velocity, that could be a couple of different things. You know, not an awesome start, but not too bad. But, you know, if you don't have velocity at the bottom of the track, you usually have to attribute that to, you know, some poor choices in driving lines or just bad equipment or, you know, a wrong choice in runner selection, something like that.
Well, it may be that her runner choice is limited to maybe one set of runners. Who knows on her sled? This little slide here gets straightened up by the wall, doesn't put her too far offline.
But very high in that curve right there. You can see she almost hit the lip.
But she didn't haul it down. She kept it up high. She knew she hauled it down, they were going to be in real trouble.
Yeah, but you can see her between curves 18 and 19, the only short straightaway, just a little bit of trouble keeping the sled running straight.
Well, there is Victoria and Kelly, and they lie in 17th spot with two sleds to come. So Alfie Willemsen and Ava Villemark of Belgium. They were here last year, but because of a time misunderstanding, they turned up an hour later than they should have and were not able to start. Coach Anna Smiddens in the background said that will never happen again.
Yeah, but there's no rear view here, and Bob said you can't look back and dwell on the past. You have to look forward and you know, hopefully do well this year.
I guarantee they were at the track before anyone else all weekend, all week long. 6:79 start. She's got another track and field athlete behind her, Hannah Marion, newly joined this Belgian program.
Seems to be setting up a little bit high for the drivers. You know, that's just kind of a sail. Not much, but you know, when the driver's helmet sticks very high out of the cowling, that's not great for aerodynamics.
Well, one of the things that you have with a sled like this one that's got that distinctive V-shaped profile of the nose is that you do get this big wedge sitting right up at driver's eye level, and so you have to kind of either look round it or over it. And her option looked to be looking over it. 123.7, she was 18th at the start. She's up to 16th at the moment, ahead of GB2 in Australia. And closing in on Anastasia Tambov-Sava of Russia. And she is just a tenth behind Tambov-Sava in 15th spot. So it was a good run again for the Belgians.
Yeah, you know, you have to contribute a little bit to her driving. They started off with a rank of 18 at the push and slowly worked up to 16th place over the course of the run. But you know, that's just pretty good driving for her.
Well, no major mistakes. Okay, she's got a good run onto six.
Staying, hugging that right wall coming to this curve. And, you know, all the pilots seem to want to get onto that curve a little bit early, even despite that bump that seems to be there.
I think the exit is putting you over onto the right, and rather than steer off and steer back, they're just taking it. Well, our final sled in this first heat of round five of the Women's Bobsleigh World Cup, Ava Villemark and Wendy van Leuven of Belgium. And of course, Ava, great for Elfie Willemsen in the 2010 Winter Games. They immediately then split the team into two. .675, 400s quicker than their teammates. And again, that shows there's so little between the two Belgian drivers.
Yeah, but it also displays a weakness in the Belgian program. They had the 16th and 18th fastest starts of the 19 sleds we've seen so far. So, you know, that just, if they can improve there, that's only going to help everything else as they go down the course.
Both drivers, and particularly for Ava, she was a brakewoman in 2010. She's a driver in 2011 and 2012. So this is her second season, and a big skip there gets her into real trouble. And of course, you know, that huge hit afterwards is really going to affect her concentration. She is still not out of danger.
Yeah, big waves coming through those curves, and you can just see the driver's head just get bounced around every time she takes those taps off the walls. Also very straight coming through that straightaway right there.
You know, that hit from the wall is like getting caught by a fast left in the ring. You know, that's just going to stun you for a couple of turns.
Yeah, it definitely hurts your reactions a little bit. You know, can obviously, you're going to bounce all around, and your arms are going to react to it. You're going to pull the D-rings just a little bit in a direction you may not want to steer the sled. You know, it's just a catastrophic event when you hit that hard.
Yeah. Apart from knocking the wind out of your sails.
So just on the curve, just a little bit too long. It just whips her head around as she comes off that curve.
Here's the big slide. Puts her completely wrong into the corner. And she hits the wall hard on the exit. But they survived without use of their helmets, so they will go in the second heat. They will be first off of our 19 sleds. And last to go will be the race leader. Kaylee Humphreys and Chelsea Valois are 4 for 4 this season. Will they make it 5 for 5 and head home to Canada at Christmas unbeaten? Well, at the moment, she has got a decent enough advantage to make you not want to put too much money on anyone else. Jamie Grubel and Alana Myers of the USA will have something to say about it. But Humphreys leads again. Fighting is for second place, Kurt Tomasevich with your teammates. But Kaylee, 2 tenths clear. It's going to be a tough bridge, that one.
Yeah, we talked about how it's going to be a little bit spread out today, and you can tell from, you know, third place to first place, a quarter of a second, and it seems fourth place, you know, a 42 hundredths of a second from our leaders. But, you know, it's not over. On this track, you know, those big leads can be overcome.
Fourth, fifth, sixth, and seventh covered by just 7 hundredths of a second. So there's going to be some changes in there, and all 19 sleds down comfortably, relatively, in the case of Ove Villemarke of Belgium. It was a fairly uncomfortable ride, but without major dramas. So my thanks to Kurt Tomasevich for his words during this first heat. Don't forget, we'll be back with the second heat, and that will come up at 45 past the hour. Stay with us for all the action here from La Plagne.